Was exactly 10 years ago, right before the final eviction, right on the steps over here. And thanks to the hospitality of the people of CHARAS El Bohio, Great Small Works had our creative home here along with many other cultural groups for 15 years. So this is the first time we've done the show in 10 years. That's why we're holding our scripts. Okay, are we ready? Is the chorus ready? Warm up, please. Is the band ready? Yes, we are. Okay, is the audience ready? Woo! Ladies and gentlemen, the true story of when the city sells our public spaces, all that's left are private places. At the turn of the century in New York City's Lower East Side, the city built a brand new public school, P.S. 64, to educate the children of immigrant families flooding into the neighborhood from Ireland, from Russia, Germany, Ukraine, Poland, and other points around the globe. For 60 years, this school served the community.
PS 64 is now open.
By the 1960s, the children and grandchildren of these immigrants moved from the neighborhood to the outer boroughs and suburbs of New York City. It was urban flight! All over the neighborhood, landlords abandoned their property. In 1975, the city says
there aren't enough children to fill the rooms of PS 64. We're going to close it down. We can't afford to take care of it anymore.
The building is abandoned, and before long, the steps of PS 64 are inhabited, are covered with garbage, and swarming with rats. The junkies steal the copper from the roof!
Oh no!
And the top two stories are destroyed by water damage!
Terrible!
When the city sells our public spaces, all that's left are private places.
Flippo! Then, in 1965, six Puerto Rican ex-gang members from the Assassins decide to form what they call the Real Great Society.
Yay!
In 1979, they take over this building, clean it up with help from volunteers from all over the neighborhood, and turn it into a community center.
Yay!
Yay! Yay! They call it El Bohio, which means the hut, and they take the CH from Chino Garcia, the AR from Armando Perez, and the AS from Bimbo Rivas.
Yeah.
And call their new center
CHARAS EL BOHIO.
And chorus here. Okay.
They start after school literacy programs for neighborhood youth.
Yay!
They organize for housing and tenants' rights.
Yay!
They promote Puerto Rican culture through music, theater, and dance.
Yay!
Dancers!
Yay!
And painters come to CHARAS for studio space to perform and mount exhibitions.
Yay!
Great Small Works has a studio in CHARAS where they rehearse and build shows.
Yay!
When community gardens are threatened by the city, the gardeners come to CHARAS to organize opposition.
Yay!
Recycle a Bike uses CHARAS to rebuild and recycle bikes and to teach youth how to do it too.
Yay!
Alcoholics Anonymous hold weekly meetings at CHARAS, serving over 800 people a month.
Woo!
Hello, my name is Mike.
Yeah, we got some bikes and some strides.
I don't know, I got to talk with all of you. I got to
give them away to kids.
I've been trying, but I can't do it myself.
Then, in 1992, Bimbo Rivas passes away.
When the city sells our public spaces, all that's left are private spaces.
Flippo! Flippo! By the 1990s, real estate is booming in the neighborhood, and CHARAS becomes a hot commodity for potential developers. The city says,
we are getting out of the landlord business. Let's sell this old school building to the highest bidder.
But the people of CHARAS say,
the city
built this public building
with public funds for the public.
And now the city wants the public to buy its own building back so that it can remain public.
Huh?
Oh, we're the city. CHARAS is put on the auction block three times. The first time, people write so many letters that the city has to cancel the auction. The second time, there are so many demonstrations against the sale that the bidders are scared away and nobody bids on it. Finally, on July 20th, 1998, when Charas and 50 community gardens are put on the auction block together, protesters sneak into the auction and release 10,000 crickets, stopping the sale. For about 45 minutes. Let's do business! All right. What do I hear for this wonderful building, 605?
Wait a minute! I'm Gregg Singer, a shady real estate developer from the Upper East Side. I'll buy that building for $3.15 million.
Sold to the man with the banana in his pocket! And we'll explain that banana shortly. Charas is sold. But the people of Charas don't give up. They try to stop the sale before it can be finalized. They march to City Hall with stilters and a brass band.
We've been here for 20 years. We fixed up the building when no one else wanted it.
But I bought it fair and square.
They protest at Gregg Singer's house on his birthday. March. You stay out of our neighborhood and we'll stay out of yours.
I love artists. I'd make a great landlord for artists.
When Gregg Singer brings potential investors to look at the building, the people of Charas chase them down the street.
Viva Charas!
What are you complaining about? I'm going to turn it into a hostel for European yuppies. I'll call it the Banana Bungalow.
Oh, bananas. The struggle gains momentum as community activists and councilwoman Margarita Lopez and public activist Mark Green with the glasses there all join the fight to save Charas.
Yeah, you've got Susan Sarandon too. Who cares?
And we have Reverend Billy too. Then, in April 1999, Armando Perez is murdered in Queens.
Oh no. I had nothing to do with that.
Finally, Charas decides to sue the city to prevent the deed from being transferred. But the judge is a friend of Mayor Giuliani's, and he throws the case out of court. So the Federal Department of Housing and Urban Development gets involved and tries to get the city to cancel the sale. They say,
we put money into this building and we say it must be used for nonprofit purposes.
But the city says,
who cares? We don't have to listen to you.
The people of Charas demonstrate at the courthouse and 10 activists block the street and are arrested. Despite all these attempts, on July 22nd, 2000, the deed to Charas El Bohio is transferred from the city to Gregg Singer.
Congratulations, Gregg. Enjoy your new building.
Thanks, Rudy. The check's in the mail.
Okay, sorry. But, ladies and gentlemen, the story does not end here. The people of Charas say,
we're not finished.
In January 2001, Charas was in court again. In a winner-take-all jury trial, 8 anonymous New Yorkers and total strangers to Charas vote unanimously that Gregg Singer has not proved his intent to use the building for community use, and thus could not evict Charas.
I'll appeal that.
Singer's appeal proved successful, and the judge declared the jury trial moot. She ordered Charas to leave the building, and the people of Charas say,
we're not leaving!
But after many more months of struggle, just before Christmas of 2001, Singer finally succeeded in evicting the people of Charas El Bohio. But, ladies, Ladies and gentlemen, you may think that Gregg Singer had won the fight, but in the 10 years since emptying the people out of CHARAS El Bohio, he has failed to make a dime off the building. Yay. Banana Bungalow went bust.
Ha!
He wasn't able to turn the building into overpriced condo units with a nursing home in the basement.
Ha!
He wasn't able to go through with his suit to sue all the individual tenants for $1 million each.
Ha!
And he couldn't even convince NYU to turn it into student housing. And his final scheme was...
Wait till it falls down on its own. Then I can build what I want.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, if you look at this building here, you will see that it's still vacant and boarded up. What
a waste!
It's time to take CHARAS away from Gregg Singer and give it back to the people of New York and the people. And the people of New York say,
now the city's filled with private places. We must fight for public spaces.
And that, ladies and gentlemen, is the very true story of CHARAS El Bohio. Thank you very much.
And the eviction of CHARAS was a huge police action. There were maybe 30 people inside, but there were helicopters, there were hundreds of riot police, and they carried out 10 activists. It was a ridiculous police maneuver to rid this neighborhood of an organizing hub. And since that time, it has sat vacant, and we have not had a space to organize. We need this space back. The
yes.
city needs this space back, and we need to continue to fight to do that.
When we first moved into this building was empty, that building was empty, and there was a whole bunch of buildings over there that were all empty. You know, and those buildings was almost going to be empty because the landlord abandoned it. And to adapt the building, we organized those buildings, and we developed a Plaza Cultural that has some of the most beautiful little trees. After we did the Plaza Cultural and a few other parks in the neighborhood with Liz Christie, now the whole movement went all around the city. And there's thousands of gardens all over the city. But one of the first things is that at this building we did the first, you know, and we did the first solar energy system in any urban area. Now there's thousands. We did the first sweat equity building in any urban area, and now there's thousands of people doing sweat equity and squatting all over the country. So it's important, you know, that you have a place where you could start developing as an incubator a lot of projects and a lot of ideas.
Gregg Singer has had 10 years to try and help this community, and he hasn't done jack shit. We all know this, and we just want the city to know this too, and we want to let Mr. Mayor Bloomberg know this. This is our space. It belongs to us, and we hope that if we knock loud enough today, they're gonna hear us all the way at City Hall. So with that in mind, we wanna turn this blue wall that's separating the people out here from our community space in there, the 99% out here from the spaces that help us live and make life worth living. We wanna knock on this wall so loud that City Hall's gonna hear us, so let's turn this thing into a drum.
Thank you.
Back up. Back up. Back up.
This brick is holding the building. It's increasing in value as he sits on it while it rots away. That's how fucking obscene.